Okay, well, welcome everyone. We're all here and it is just 5 o'clock now, so I think we'll just get started right away. So I'm going to give a brief introduction to Carol, and then Carol will introduce all of our scholarship recipients. So welcome. Carol Ventura is a longtime WARP member and was on the scholarship selection committee this year, and she will be introducing the scholarship recipients. Before she retired in 2021, Carol was the art historian at Tennessee Technological University. Her fiber focus includes fabric processes and tapestry crochet. Her homepage at carolventura.com has links to pages she's put together that feature wood, fiber, glass, clay, and metal crafts and their makers. So, Carol, thank you for serving on the committee, and thank you for being here to introduce the scholarship recipients.
Okay, well, first let me tell you a little bit more about the scholarship. The Alice Brown Memorial Scholarship provides an opportunity each year for us to welcome young textile professionals, students, or recent graduates to our annual meeting. We have the privilege of learning about their work and research interests and hope they'll benefit from the opportunity to join WARP and learn from us as well. So I would like to introduce you to this year's conference scholarship recipients. Their education and other info is on the online conference program page and also on the WARP Facebook page. So I won't go over that, but what you might not know is that the three Brazilian recipients are students of WARP member Dr. Soraya Coppola. Thank you, Soraya, for telling them about the scholarship. And the recipient from Mexico is the son of Faye and Lola, whose studio in Teotitlan we visited during the 2017 WARP conference in Oaxaca, Mexico. So a lot of connection there. I hope all of you will also share this scholarship information with your family, friends, students, so we can invite even more people next year. And these recipients hopefully will be able to meet everyone in person at our next conference next year, since we didn't have one this year in person. So each of them will discuss their work for 10 minutes. They're all very nervous about presenting in English, but their English is much better than our Portuguese and Spanish, I'm sure. So please post your questions in the chat box, and then after all four presentations, we'll answer as many questions as we can, or they will. And we'll begin with Daniela Pedrosa, a Brazilian fashion design graduate who's also a weaver and a storyteller. Daniela?
Thank you, Carol. Thank you, Kelsey, for the presentation. I'm gonna share my screen with you guys. Foi? Hi, everyone. I would like to thank the community of Weaving Peace for this opportunity. I'm very glad to be here today talking to you. And I would like to show you where I grew up and live. That's my neighborhood called Alto Veracruz in the suburbs of the city of Belo Horizonte and the states of Minas Gerais in Brazil. I had my first contact with hand weaving in college through a discipline called fiber arts. At the time, my mental health was very fragile, and experiencing with weaving brought me a lot of connections with my creative and conscious side, which was half asleep. I came to show you a work that was important in my trajectory with weaving called The Same You, which is translated like Weaving Me. It was presented as my conclusion in degree in fashion design. Weaving's techniques are like magical formulas in which weaving accompanies remembering through the reading of the various techniques of knots and tensions between lines that speaks time and a time. The work with with weaving is intended to approach the expanded capacity of consciousness, bearing in mind symbolic, creative, and perceptual aspects. One of the authors that I read for my research, called Thais Vance, says that the weaver, as an artisan, has in his craft a path that can lead him to get in touch with his virtues and vices in a structured way, being able to symbolize the individual and group contents, expanding their awareness as they absorb images of the unconscious, giving them expression. More and more, I could understand the meaning of this speech through the experience of weaving. Part of the work was the historical and technical research on weaving, where I got to know many international and national references. At the moment, international renowned artists like Annie Albers and Gute Stones caught my attention. Also, one of the important names in textile art in Brazil is Norberto Nicola, where his productions involve a variety of materials from roots, feathers, vines, and traditional tapestry materials such as wool, lino, sisal, and others. These names inspire me to weave. Another important name for my research was the Uruguayan Luis Ernesto Arostegui. His artistic production as a tapestry artist was always a search for the exercise of the technique, that is creation and experimentation. His method of teaching tapestry served me as a source of learning. Part of my experimentation was doing drawings and paintings. And part of my inspiration to design was in fauves and works by Henri Matisse, which inspired me to think about colors and shapes. I developed drawings, paintings with gouache and watercolors where I sought a colorful harmony, organic shapes, and expression of sensations that I could explain. Wool and cotton fiber inspire me the textures and the stitch that I choose to work with. Among the developed collection, the piece chosen for the confection was this one. The execution of the piece follow a stage of modeling, construction of the nail loom, choice of materials and techniques, and the weaving stage. Choosing among the various textile resources, which is best suited to each design situation to transmit the sensation evoked in the work, was the challenge for me to overcome. With this in mind, the design of the piece is composed of curves and different proportions. So I decided to work weaving techniques in most parts and tapestry knots in the space that form the curves. Knots work create volumes that emphasize the curves of the design, providing movement, dimension, and varied textures. To provide a diversity of colors, the yarns chosen for the job were combined during the process. In addition to executing the chosen piece, what I was looking for when I was working with weaving was a greater connection with myself, a rescue of myself that was lost for a while. During the course of the work, this became more and more clear. And with the help of weaving, it began to take hold on me. Manual work opened new paths for my creativity, patience, and discipline. I believe the connection to weaving already exists in me even before I experienced it. My grandmother, Amelia, who you met in the beginning of this presentation, was 100 years old when I did this work. One day, she spent the afternoon at my house while I was weaving. And she started telling me stories about her childhood in the countryside and describing memories in which my great-great-grandmother, Mariana, weaved and other women did textile work, like cotton preparation and spinning. In her stories, I found such a great meaning for the whole process I went through, meanings that continue to mature with me to create more works. After this work, I continue with the research on weaving, thinking of as a creative, educational, and therapeutic support. Here are some studies. And through my experience in public school with elementary school children, I decided to invest in my training as an art teacher and textile artist. And this, as these are the places I believe in and move my creative force. This inspired me to continue my research in weaving, and my interests now are to study regional weaving in Minas Gerais, regions where my family came from, and together with the Studiolo group, coordinated by Professor Soraya, we are producing and exchanging knowledge about textile research. And these are the places that I love. My school library, where I work and learn so much with the kids, and the textile classroom at the university. That's it. Thank you for your attention. Obrigada.
Well, thank you very much, Daniela. Now we'll hear from Omar Chavez Santiago. He's an engineer from a family of weavers in Teotitlan del Valle in Oaxaca, Mexico. Omar?
Yes. Can you all see my presentation?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so hello. Thank you very much for having me this afternoon. It is an honor to me to be part of this annual WARP meeting of this year. Welcome, everybody. I am excited to share more of my work with you, and I appreciate your time. Thank you, Carol. Thank you, Kelsey, for this opportunity. Let's get started. My name is Omar Chavez Santiago. I am from the Zapotec town of Teotitlan del Valle, Oaxaca. I'm 27 years old, and I represent a fourth generation of weavers and dyers in my family. I run a one-man weaving operation, performing all the different aspects in my process, from dyeing my yarn using only natural dyes to the making of my own designs. I learned how to weave in a petal loom using a tapestry technique from my parents when I was 7 years old. In this image, you can see in the right side, my mother, Dolores Santiago, and in the left side, my father, Federico Chavez. I started as an assistant of my dad. I was in charge to wind his bobbins so he can be focused in his weaving process. Also, I was assigned to gather all the leftovers of wool that were in my parents' loom and packed them by color. So there was lots of responsibilities for a kid. So as a member of a living culture and son of a weavers and dyers that had dedicated their life to preserve the weaving tradition within my family, I got inspired to create something different and to weave my own story. My work lies precisely in my production process, which is based in the natural timing of my materials that I work with. Each step is marked by the rhythm and peculiar properties of each individual plant, fruit, and fiber I use. Here I'm going to show you, these are some pictures of the dyes I work with, such as wild marigold flower, zapote fruit, pomegranate, cochineal, and indigo. Most of these dyes, I can get them locally with my neighbors or families that they will own a pomegranate or zapote tree. They will charge me less if I'm the one that goes to the directly to the tree and grab the fruit. Here, to grind the cochineal, I use a metate. Another important thing about my process and my work is that my color palette will go as the season of each plant and fruit I use. My proposal in my work is to blend traditional motifs with a modern vision. Usually, I will develop my work without having any sketch, and I will do it something I call freehand. In this image, this is a 4x5 feet rug. The dyes are indigo, cochineal, and pomegranate. One of the challenge in this piece was, if you can see the corners of the rug, it's not square. I had to weave it like in a like a curve, so I can have a rounded edges. This is another work I've been developing. I create the shape of these stairs, trying to create this 3D effect. So what I really like is to weave very organic shape. That's also one of the things that I love. I get inspired by my surrounding, by the nature. So all of these pieces that you see here, they've been my work during this lockdown. Weaving circles is one of the hardest techniques to achieve in this kind of weaving. So this lockdown have given me the enough time to keep practicing and keep learning at my studio. So in the right side, you can see my first circle rug I did. It took me almost 5 weeks to weave. And the challenge was to create the perfect circle. And after that, with a braiding of the same color of each color you see in the rug, add this braiding so you can have, I can have like this very nice ending. However, this lockdown also helped me to learn and develop more skills. I've been using different apps in my devices so I can visualize now how a rug will look. So this is something that I'm really focused now. So in order to improve and to have a better vision of my work, this is something that I'm doing. Usually I will start with very abstract shapes. And in the left side, if you can see, there's this brown paper, which is the scale of the piece. So this is something that I have to draw all by hand before I'm going to weave it. And here I have, in the left side is the final piece. These images are some of the my recently work I've been doing. One of the things that I like is I want to create very versatile pieces. So you can just flip or turn the rug and you will still have a sense of the design. This is one of my favorite projects, which I call watercolor. The idea in this carpet was to reproduce this effect of the water, the color, how the color expands when you're using watercolor. This is my another lockdown project. It took me a lot of time to weave. And the final rug. If you see, I'm blending a lot of traditional motifs like the stepped greca that you can see in the center of this rug. And this is one of my mission is to be an inspiration of more young weavers, more young creators from my region, from my city. So it is important that the new generations can value the importance of preserving these ancient practices and value the importance of staying in our hometowns. So this is my information, and thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Omar. Now we'll hear from Sofia Zorzi, a Brazilian weaver interested in natural dyeing and wearables. Sofia?
Oh, I'm going to share my screen. Have a problem? So thank you for introducing me, Carol. Well, I want to thank Waverio Place for the opportunity of being here today. I'm so grateful for being selected for this meeting. It's a great honor. In today's presentation, I would like to show a project called Manifesto do Tempo que Habito, or A Manifest of My Own Time, one of my latest works. It's a very special project to me. To it, I dedicated so much time and energy. I must say that English is a language which I have a reductive vocabulary at my disposal. So I apologize if somehow I do not make myself clear enough or say something wrong. But I'm confident that my work will speak for itself. So first, I will share a video telling about my poetic, my creative process. So please let me know if the video is playing and if the sound comes out good.
Yes, it's playing. Oh yes, I hear the birds.
We could say that manufacturing is a creational process that is old as time. It has its origin forged in our collective memory and in our ancestral knowledge. The act of dyeing and weaving are also threads of the intricate entwining of pasts that unfold into the making of the present. Colors can be printed through plants, memories come to be through textures. Feeling the emptiness is a natural act of creation. In this way, when spaces are occupied, the fabric starts to come into shape. I like to think about the process as a fundamental moment for experimentation and the space of integration and connection between me and the material. The memories and personal recordings of the little choice that I took, I live in the dyeing and the weaving. Intuition guides me and lets me walk new paths that sense the work as creative work unfolds. This organicity happens through the fluidity of shapes and multiplicity of textures. What calls on me is also what gives me space to create and imagine. I always feel fascinated by the dancing movements that trees manifest with the company of the wind. For me, it is the most immersive state of contemplation and mindfulness, something that I can contemplate for hours. And it still would be powerful and beautiful. In this moment, time exists in a particular and welcoming way. Undressed of any kind of waste, it is only made of present. This experience was fundamental so I could create the Manifesto do Tempo que Habito, a project in which my research was exactly to register this time through matter.
So, Manifesto do Tempo que Habito is a project made between December 2020 and March 2021, all made of natural fibers, such as cotton, wool, and silk. I was interested in creating textures and drawings with the lines. So you can observe that the texture that I weaved resembles aquatic forms and structures, such as corals. As an element of our emotion and sensibility, water is also a metaphor for our unconsciousness. For the dyeing process, I used Pau Brasil, Brazil wood, the tree that gave my country's name. It's the tree that for a while was at risk of extinction. Now it needs to be used carefully. It's a meaningful tree for us. Here are some pictures of Pau Brasil. I also used capillary action as an extra way to capture the time as a natural process that liquids act on surfaces. Now I'm going to share the video art, Manifesto do Tempo que Habito. I took 2 days to record this video, and this is the result. And that brings me to the end of this presentation. Thank you for your attention. Obrigada.
Well, thank you so much, Sofia. Okay, we just have one more, another Brazilian artist, João Marcos Lisboa da Rocha, who focuses on wearable textiles that he weaves with naturally dyed organic fibers. João?
Hi, anyone, everyone. I thank you with help for this opportunity. I'm very happy and grateful. I apologize for my speak at some moment. I am still in the process of learning the English language. Okay. Confirm to me, is a visible a presentation, please?
Yes, it is.
Okay. I present the title for my present project. It's connected with doing and redoing, and she's developing the connective process which making textiles, remaking to remake the cut, like the invisible doing. She is remaking of invisible darning. The Harry will take us to process of memory, being the guiding thread of the entry process. Remake the cut, like the invisible darning. Living with my grandmothers in my childhood, I create a strong connection with the plants, the countryside, and the windows of the nature. At the university's fiber and weaving studios, or time the craft practiced in developing a dialogue with the memories and many stories around me. These are some of my work, which seek to dialogue with my memories and with the practice of the weaving studio. And grow up in a region which a landscape reminiscence of a living tapestry in continuous growth. It manifests in me a growing desire to weave. I draw a landscape, touch abstract shapes and colors, such that manifest itself as a map, is a mapping or cartography of affections. Fibers work in the process, cotton, wool, linen, silk, myelin. Cotton and wood yarns are in use. In small details, threads of linen and silk are used. It's a dyeing process. In the dyeing fiber craning process, a homemade detergent is used. Adapting for soup receptive to my grandmother. O dyeing process, o mortant, usa de pseudon guadava e o fixativo é potássio, potássio alum. Numerous native plants and common plants in your daily life are used in the natural dyeing process. One of the plants in the bicha Orulana, Gurukum, plant present in popular traditional and the stories and daily life of native peoples. Through this species of Indigofera sulfaticosa is an anilera, a plant native. My region, the process is slow and full of good surprise. It's a the vertical loom used in the weaving process. I feel light in front of the portal to assess incommunicable rains. Variation of some sticks and knots, fiber encounters, memory thread encounters. On fibers as finished the process, as a fabric finished process, has a ritual way for in self to make the necessary learning time and the and go through countries. It's a memory crotch, the readable manifest with yourself in a crook of the memory, the cows, the winters, and the make a home materializing in small fragments of the great tapestry of life. The process of ring as a refraction, the process of the ring as refracting, the process of research and encounters, the entry process has grown by my professor Soraya and together in the Studiolo group. We are dedicated yourselves to seeking dialogue with trans ancestral practice. Thank you all for the time waived. Thank you.
Oh my gosh, I am so impressed with each and every one of you and your work. And you are poets. You have such a wonderful way of speaking about your work and what you're trying to do. And I see such a connection with the past and the future. And I'm so impressed also with your art studies, and I'm just blown away. I'm so impressed. If anyone has questions for these wonderful scholarship recipients, Kelsey is going to handle that, and you can ask them in the chat.
Yes, I have to echo Carol's sentiments. This is so impressive, and it's really such an honor for us to have you here. Mm. Thank you so much for sharing your work. We've had a lot of really nice comments come in, but no questions yet. So please do send some questions. We have about 20 minutes. So I do see the first one that came through just now says, do you have career plans to continue your art, or what are your career plans to continue your art? So you can just take turns answering that.
Well, for me, I am trying to set a place to fit all the looms and the materials, and I have been working for my financial stability to take the proper time to dedicate to my art. So now I have a place and more stability. So I'm working in my portfolio so I can share my works and try to exhibit the work. And I want to align this with my practice in the school, with classes and studies, how I can combine my knowledge with the children. And so, and that's it. The time in Brazil is very difficult for art and cultural professionals. But we are trying to get together and to stay more stronger. We are planning a coletivo, I don't know how to speak in English, collective group in art, in textile art. So we can share more things and we can try more exhibitions and bigger works, you know.
Yes, we are planning to work together, me, Daniela, and João, because we are very connected. I imagine you can see. And I think we are interested in waving, in dying, so connecting, in creating a group is a way to be around together and working.
Yeah, and to me, I'm very interested now in having a bigger background about designing. I'm every day I practice. I'm weaving every day. I'm experimenting with different dyes all the time. So I'm now seeking. I'm looking forward to have a bigger background in design, because I really would like to see more possibilities that I can do on a pedal loom regarding with the weaving, with designing.
I increasingly seeking to dialogue with my art practice and bring popular force to my practices.
Wonderful, thank you all. Drell, there's a question specifically for you that says, who has influenced and inspired your work apart from your abuela?
Repeat, please, por favor. Repeat, please.
What was the question?
Who has influenced, Dress shared the pictures and the stories of his abuelas. Who has influenced his work in addition, besides his grandmother's?
O João, quem influenciou o trabalho do João?
Isso, a pergunta, quem influenciou o trabalho do João?
I will translate for him, okay?
Além da sua avó.
Além da sua avó, quem influenciou o seu trabalho têxtil? Pode responder em português?
Okay. Tá, eu vou falar em português e minha amiga Daniela traduzirá.
I will translate for you.
Quando eu comecei a estudar artes, criei um forte diálogo nos ateliês e descobri mestres do saber, de saberes muito antigos que buscam, através desses saberes, dialogar entre suas práticas artísticas em suas obras. A minha professora, Joyce Saturnino, é uma artista da fibra, nacional, e ela busca esses diálogos em seus fazeres minhas referências.
Deixa eu traduzir, peraí.
Ok.
Well, when he started to study art in college, he got to know a lot of older teachers and weavers, like Joyce Saturnino, which was a teacher at New York University. And he created a very strong connection with her and others. So he started to weave in there, more there than ever. And para falar, João.
Junto com essas conexões dentro dos ateliês, eu acabei descobrindo memórias familiares. Minha mãe confessa para mim que a minha avó, quando jovem, tecia e também criava objetos de cerâmica para seu uso no dia a dia. E isso foi sendo uma prática que eu trouxe para meu fazer, como uma memória somada à minha. Contemporaneamente...
Uhum. Deixa eu falar. And when he started to study this the weaving, the ceramic things, and he started to know the connection with his family. His mother started to tell him about his grandmother, who was a weaver, and know a lot of traditional techniques like weaving, ceramics. And so he started to approach this language in his work. Mais alguma coisa, João?
E contemporaneamente, eu busco dialogar muito o meu fazer, dialogando com as notas, as anotações de memórias da artista Louise Bourgeois. Admiro muito o processo e as obras de Louise.
And with his work, he's also very inspired by the work of Louise Bourgeois. And I think she's a very big reference for him and for me too. We studied this a lot at university. And this forms a lot of the background of practicing, our family, our teachers, and some artists. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that with us. We have another question. This one is for Omar. Omar, can you please talk about when you started to weave, what have your challenges been? And how do you market what you and your family make?
So I start to learn how to weave since I was 7 years old. And the challenging was I was being a student and also a weaver. So while I was growing, I was not having like more time to weave, and because I was focused on school. So as I've been growing, I've been discovering the importance of keeping my tradition alive. So I think when I was younger, like that was a challenge, you know, because I was like the only in the group of my friends, I was like the only one that can make something with their hands. So it was like rare to see someone like that. So I was like shy about telling more about the people about it. But now I'm very, very proud. I'm very happy with the work I am doing. And yeah, it's been a challenge. It's been a journey working with natural dyes. It's been a challenge to raise awareness about the labor intense and the time consuming process that evolves to do something with your hands from beginning to the end. And I'm very thankful and I'm very happy that I have found people, that I have found more ways to have a louder voice, and I can reach a broader public, and my idea, and I can be the voice not for only my family or my community, my entire town. And I'm very, very, very happy and looking forward to the future.
Wonderful. Thank you, Omar. We have time for probably one or two more, a couple more questions. So please, I think we've gone through what we had. Please do send us a couple more if you have questions. One just came in, and I'll just read it right out. It says, so many people in the United States and other areas are very interested in natural dyeing. Please share with us if you have any unusual plants or substances that you use for dyeing, maybe things that are specific to your countries or your region.
Joãozinho, você sabe alguma planta específica diferente da região para tingimento? Estão perguntando isso.
Da região, minha região ou...
Do Brasil.
Do Brasil?
Do Brasil.
Ok, eu vou falando e você traduz, por favor. Todo o processo que eu apresentei, ele contém inúmeras plantas nativas e do nosso uso comum, porque muitas plantas são temperos, são medicinais, e algumas delas variam muito de lugar para lugar. Aqui eu mostro a anileira, Angiofera sulfructicosa. Ela está presente em todo o país, mas ela vai variar de espécie para espécie na sua família. Eu consigo azul com ela. Temos urucum, que é uma planta tradicional dos povos originários, e ela é usada em nosso dia a dia. Eles a usam para pintar seu corpo, para rituais ligado a questões de crença. Ela está muito presente nas histórias, em suas lendas, na medicina, na culinária.
Só as plantas, essas a gente... Qualquer índigo?
Índigo, tem o pariri.
Do you know, we use here a lot of índigo, pariri.
Pariri, que também se chama cajiru. Cúrcuma.
Which is called cajiru, too. Cúrcuma.
Catuaba.
Catuaba. Urucum, we already told.
Alguns líquens que dão especificamente algumas árvores daqui também.
It's a lot of spices and plants of the region. Eu acho que o...
Jabuticaba is a fruit that I think
Omar, you're gonna say
I was going to say, we have this native fruit from Mexico, which is a zapote. I have looked for the word in English, but I don't find it. So the zapote, with the zapote, we can get all these brown shades. And also there's this other, it's called a lengua de vaca, and actually works as a natural mordant. So instead of using alum, we can use the lengua de vaca leaf. And obviously it will give like a beige color to the yarn, but it will help to absorb the color.
Thank you all for that. And we have a list that Sophia put into the chat, which is very useful too. So thank you. Omar, can you talk about where you sell your work so that we know where to find it?
Everybody visit Mexico, visit Oaxaca, And in Teotitlan, I have my small studio, which is in my home, and also by Instagram. And during this lockdown, I did like a lot of sales through Instagram. So I will add it on the chat if that's okay, my Instagram, so you can have a direct connection with me. Thank you.
Thank you. And do any of the rest of you, is there anywhere we can find more of your work? We shared your email addresses. Is there anything else you'd like to share?
I will share a blog that I made.
By now, I just have my email. I'm working on a social media to expose my work. And João também. Also, João has only his email.
Okay, wonderful. When you have your social media, we discussed that the other day. You'll send it to us and we'll share it with our WART members, because I know everyone will be really excited to follow your work.
Thank you.
And we have...
I will follow you too.
Wonderful. We have just a couple of minutes left. There's one question I want to find back that I think would be nice to end with. This is from Kathy, and it says, how do you feel it is best to communicate with young people such as yourselves about the value of handcraft? And Omar, you started to talk about this.
Yeah, so what I've been doing is I'm using color. I'm using like a lot of different shapes in order to make something handmade, like very, very modern, and can be interested in, and can be, and more people of young people can get that inspiration and see that there's limitless possibilities of creating something very, very new, very special, and that's the way I've been helping, and I've been supporting my community. I like to talk with neighbors. I like to talk with cousins. And something that I've been doing is, sorry if I mentioned a lot of Instagram, but I think that's how I'm reaching more people. And I like to share my stories. I like to share my day to day. And it's always an invitation to all, because I have cousins that are from my town, and they are following me there. And I all the time like saying, yeah, keep weaving, or innovative. It needs to, the tradition needs to evolve in order also to preserve it. So feel free to create. And so that's how I've been trying to keep my message.
Thank you, Omar. We have just about 1 or 2 minutes if any of the rest of you would like to talk about how you think about discussing the value of handcrafts.
I think my, as I am seeing with people of my age, we are getting more interested in this technique because of the process, because of the patience we can work through it. We are dealing with so much digital things that is getting so overwhelming. So the process is very the key to communicate your inner self so much deeper, that things that we are needing in this time. So I think it's something that gets a lot of the attention from and the designs, the colors, the textures, it's so lovely, and that's it's calling the attention too.
Thank you so much, Daniela. we are just out of time. So I would just like to say thank you again to all of you for the lovely presentations that you prepared and for being our newest board members. We're so glad to have you here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Gracias.